Good morning, and good afternoon, good evening, everyone. My name is Thomas Neubert. I am the Senior Director for Strategic Business Development and Innovation at Intel. I'm here in Silicon Valley, beautiful California. And I'm also the co-founder of GABA, the German-American Business Association, which is also based in Silicon Valley. It's a nonprofit that fosters transatlantic business relations, and we have done that for the last 18 years between Silicon Valley and Germany. So first, let me point out that today's session is co-hosted between the US Consulate in Munich and Lab Campus. And I assume in a few minutes, Sarah will share more about Lab Campus afterwards. I would also like to introduce the panel before we start the session. First of all, and I'm going kind of in sequence here, the way they're appearing on my screen, we have Florian Dollner. He is the lead for European affairs at Argo AI. Hi, Florian. We have Diane Chow. She's the senior director of global alliances and policy at Virgin Hyperloop. Welcome. We have Dr. Klaus Behringer, global head of digital and customer services and ITS Digital Labs at Intelligent Traffic System Siemens Mobility GmbH in Germany. Hello, Klaus. And then last but not least, Sarah Whitlieb. She is the vice president and sales and innovation for LAT Campus, the co-host here for this particular event. So quick intro. So all of us are kind of thrilled to be part of this Transatlantic Innovation Week 2021. I had the honor to actually participate in one of the other fireside chats last night with your counterpart in Hamburg, and in partnership with the US mission to Germany and the partners across both the United States and Germany. So energizing transatlantic cooperation and stimulating the innovation bridge is of course the central theme of this week. We are therefore especially excited to welcome the United States Consul General for Bavaria, Megan Gregorius. Madam Consul, thanks very much for being here, and I would like to hand it over to you.
Great, thanks a lot, Thomas. And thanks especially for taking the time to moderate today's exciting discussion all the way from Silicon Valley in California. And hello, everyone. Thanks for joining today's panel discussion, The Future of Mobility, How to Realize New Mobility Solutions. My name is Megan Gregonis, and I'm the Consul General at the U.S. Consulate here in Munich. We are excited to celebrate Transatlantic Innovation Week this week across Germany, an initiative that we innovated right here in Munich. Transatlantic Innovation Week highlights our enduring partnership, the importance of both American and German leadership in innovation, the cultivation and protection of innovation, and more importantly, it emphasizes the diversity and inclusion are vital drivers of creativity and innovation. The German-American corporate partnership has been at the forefront of innovation for decades, driving us all toward a more modern, sustainable, and technologically advanced future. This is truly an example for others to follow. Mitigating climate change and leveraging new sustainable resources is a priority for both our countries and for the world. Global sustainability goals and economic uncertainties create new challenges, especially for the mobility sector, which requires new solutions, strategies, and inventions that we can only master together. Bavaria is a prime example of a fruitful economic relationship between Germany and the United States. The Munich area in particular, and might I say the German Silicon Valley, is clearly a magnet for tech, mobility, and innovators like Intel, Siemens, Microsoft, Apple, Google, IBM, BMW, Unternehmertum, Lilium, Lab Campus, and many, many more. And US-Bavarian corporate partnerships in the field of mobility have become increasingly important. The key to new concepts of mobility lies in cross-country and cross-industry collaboration. New mobility is an emerging sector that generates new possibilities in many industries. It opens doors to new markets, new concepts and perspectives, and indeed a more sustainable future. Key trends around the industry, such as autonomous driving, connectivity, and the electrification of vehicles, will change our lives, our ways of moving, and our cities' infrastructures forever. The number of new businesses in this sector and the speed at which they are emerging can only give us an idea of what it has in store for us in the near future. In today's discussion, our panelists from five really innovative companies will discuss why global, cross-company, and professionally independent cooperation is necessary right now. We are excited to partner with Lab Campus, Argo AI, Virgin Hyperloop, Unix Traffic by Siemens Mobility, and Intel. And I would also like to give a warm welcome to our panelists today, Florian Dolner from Argo AI, Diana Zhao from Virgin Hyperloop, Dr. Klaus Behringer from Unix Traffic by Siemens Mobility, and Sarah Wittlieb, a good friend. Hello, Sarah, from Lab Campus. And a special thanks to our moderator, Thomas Neubert of Intel. Thank you all for your partnership and for your participation in this first U.S. mission to Germany, Transatlantic Innovation Week 2021. Back to you, Thomas.
Great. Megan, thank you very much. And welcome again, everybody. Also, welcome everybody who has dialed into this hopefully very exciting conversation over the next remaining 50 minutes or so. It will be a very interesting discussion, and I'm excited to host the session. So with that in mind, let me remind everybody, the session today, the topic is how to realize new mobility solutions by transatlantic collaboration. And when we discussed this a little bit a few days ago to just brainstorm what the topic is and everything else, I think the first thing is to set the stage and define what the meaning really is. So if I could ask anybody in the podium here, what's the definition of new ability and how does it relate to your organization? And also give a quick overview of your organization, your role, your objectives, and please, you know, build in the answer to your definition of new mobility, because it could be defined differently depending on the viewpoint. So maybe ladies first, I would assume. Diane, if you wanna start, please. Or Sarah.
Whoops. Oh, there we go. Hi, everyone. Thank you guys so much for having me here. It's really a pleasure to be here. I'm speaking to you all from Los Angeles, California today, and we're really excited to be a part of this Transatlantic Innovation Week panel. I'm Diana Zhao, and I'm our Senior Director of Global Business Development at Virgin Hyperloop. And I want to start, Thomas, by responding to your question about what is mobility, because I think this is such an interesting question. When we talk about mobility, when we talk about the future of mobility, I actually think that new mobility is not actually about mobility at all, but about creating an experience for customers that allows them to spend time in the way they want to and with the people they want to. And in this way, this new version of mobility is about almost the reduction of mobility. It's about creating a seamless, pleasant experience that saves time for people, that creates a system that's easy to use, that will get customers, passengers to their destinations as quickly and as safely as possible. At Virgin Hyperloop, we are impacting the way people view space and time. So today, if you ask how far Los Angeles is to Las Vegas. That's Los Angeles is my home, and we have a test site in Las Vegas. So many of us actually frequently make this journey. You generally hear the answer to that question 4 or 5 hours driving, you know, maybe even as much as 7 or 8 hours if there's a lot of traffic, and maybe it's an hour by plane. But in the future, the way we think about distance and about time is completely different. I mean, imagine being able to make that trip with a Hyperloop in just 30 minutes. And imagine what that can do in terms of being able to travel to, for us at least, at Virgin Hyperloop, being able to travel to Las Vegas for work and still be able to make it home for dinner at the end of the day. So we are building a technology that will change all of this. And for those of you who may not be as familiar with Hyperloop and with what it is, think of it like a long-range autonomous vehicle network. So we start with a series of pods, and a pod can carry up to 28 passengers, or it can carry palletized cargo. The pods levitate using magnets from a track, and they're electrically propelled forward, so very similar to an electric vehicle. We then put all of that into a reduced pressure structure, so like a tube, and we designed the entire thing to travel as fast as 1,000 kilometers an hour. Virgin Hyperloop as a company has spent the last 7 years developing this very new and very exciting technology. We are privately funded, based in Los Angeles, with just over 300 employees. And as I mentioned, we have a 500 meter long test track in the Las Vegas desert, where a good number of our engineers spend a lot of their time. Just last November, we conducted the first passenger test on Hyperloop, which is an incredibly exciting moment for us. We had four people travel safely in a Hyperloop. It was the first time anybody in the world has traveled in a Hyperloop. And it really was an incredible milestone for the company as well as for the technology. So I encourage all of you guys who may be interested to watch that video on our YouTube channel. It was really a very exciting and tremendous moment for us.
Great. Thank you very much. So maybe just a quick follow-up question on that one. It's interesting that you said mobility in the future is really not about mobility anymore. You know, we measure it by time, by whatever. Are we going to measure it more by productivity? Because you still went from like 6 hours, well, Los Angeles always is traffic, right? As we know. There's always traffic. So instead of 7 hours, it's five, whatever, but now you're talking in minutes. But isn't it also important to kind of redefine the time that's either being saved and turning it into productivity? If I can sit somewhere for 7 hours, even, you know, in a nice luxurious vehicle of some sort, as long as I don't have to do anything besides work, then that's a productivity enhancement. Is there a shift that is going to happen within people's mind to look at this?
I think that's a very interesting remark. And I absolutely agree with you. I think, you know, the way we're thinking about mobility, it's less about, you know, the transfer of people to get ultimately to their destination and having this very chaotic and very unreliable, unpredictable experience in that process, right? It's about how do you take that experience, how do you take that transfer time and actually recreate it and create something that is more productive, as you mentioned, create something that is a pleasant experience. We've actually done a lot of work in defining what that passenger experience in our pod could look like. And we've released some videos and stuff that I would encourage everyone to look at on our YouTube channel as well, where we've reimagined the interior of the pod. So it really feels like this safe, comfortable space where people can work if they choose to, or they can also relax if they choose to do that as well. I think your point about the productivity and being able to reuse that time from something where you're sitting in a car and you're annoyed at someone and cars are honking at you to actually an ability to create a productive environment with that is something that's going to be really interesting. And see, I think that's why there's a lot of interest in autonomous vehicles, because you're able to reutilize time in that way. And we're really, really looking forward to seeing where that goes.
Yeah, thank you. I totally agree with you. I mean, look at what we are doing here, right? We're all on Zoom or another video conferencing application. But a year ago, that was not the norm. Now everybody is doing it on a daily basis. So thanks for your feedback. I appreciate that. Sarah, same question to you. How do you define it and what do you guys do?
Yeah, I would like to start with the introduction of Lab Campus at first, because I guess this is something also quite new for a lot of people in the audience. So Lab Campus, actually, it's a cross-industry innovation campus. We are currently developing, located next to Munich Airport, with 500,000 square meters. So it's the size of almost 70 football fields, really like a small city located at the airport. And Lab Campus, we are 100% subsidiary of the airport. So next year, we will open up our first buildings, Lab 48 and Lab 52, where companies can then rent offices, prototyping areas, and showrooms. And we have a very special vision, because we want that the people really connect, create, and collaborate. So this is why we are currently realizing an innovation campus, where a variety of industries, technologies, and ideas can really converge. So the whole airport campus is involved as a test area, with innovation services like our very unique terminal test lab, where you get direct access to international passengers and you can involve them actively in your product development or gain new international leads. So our very unique benefits we have are, for example, new workplace design, because due to the pandemic, we all learned that the office of the future has to look a lot like different than today. Our innovation services with the direct access to the customers and a really managed community to foster collaboration between our residents. So, and one of our first residents is Argo AI, and we are very proud of welcoming such an autonomous driving. And this perfectly fits to our first center of excellence about new mobility. So you ask, what does it mean to us? So to my opinion, new mobility solutions are the answer to changing customer needs. So we have a lot of new megatrends like civil society, seamless travel connectivity, or also customized individualism. And those megatrends showed us already that the people have different mobility requirements. And nowadays, the solutions, they also have to fit global trends, like, for example, the Sustainable Development Goals of United Nations. So it's not only about the question how to get from A to B. It's more about the seamless travel conditions, where mobility becomes really an entertaining as a service character. Then it's even more than just the question, how will the next car look like, which I will buy. It's more a question how you connect different kind of transportation offers you've got. And of course, technology behind is crucial, but the solution shouldn't be driven by the technology only. So involving the customer in a whole development process is more than important to deliver really fitting intermodal connections. And of course, you have to involve all the new type of technologies which you can already develop now, like autonomous driving cars, air taxis like Lilium, which is discussed a lot at the moment, Hyperloop solution, of course, by Virgin Hyperloop, e-aircrafts, and they all have to be embedded by a really smart infrastructure, for example, with hydrogen fuel stations, ready to ensure a real intercoordinated transport system. So this is why I think you always have to think about your customers, and then the technology should just be the key and the solution for it, not the main target.
That is a good point. Customers first, always. Customers are always right, right? So thank you very much, Sarah. Great overview, greatly appreciate it. Florian, over to you, same question. And give us some background what you guys do.
Sure, thank you, Thomas. And I would also like to thank our co-host, the Lab Campus and the US Consulate General for inviting Argo AI to this very exciting discussion. I'm Florian Dolner. I lead European government relations for Argo AI. We develop self-driving technology for fully autonomous vehicles. We are a truly transatlantic company in the spirit of the Transatlantic Innovation Week. We are headquartered in Pittsburgh, and we have our European headquarters based in Munich, where we employ about 200 of our 1,200 strong team. When we think about new mobility, we think of essentially more mobility for more people, but at the same time, less traffic. If you think about it, millions of people currently lack the means for safely, legally, conveniently driving themselves in many places around the world. And autonomous vehicles have the potential to really changing that and making a difference in many, many people's lives by granting them access to easy mobility solutions. At the same time, AVs also provide the potential for cities and residents to live a more convenient life by reducing traffic. Because they move about in a smarter way, less congestion. There's also potential to free up parking space. So when we think about customers in the spirit of what Sarah just said, we very much think about cities and their residents in order to be able to solve some of the pain points that they have. And so that is essentially how we think about new mobility. It's not just technology, it's really the problems that technology solves.
And within that picture that you just painted, what exactly is your company doing? Is it the software stack? Is it the physical car? Is it the station? What element of that is it? Or is it the whole end-to-end solution?
So we built the software, the maps, the sensors, that type of hardware, but not the vehicle itself. We have partnerships, again, in a very transatlantic fashion with two major OEMs, Ford Motor Company and Volkswagen AG. And we will supply our technology for cars manufactured by those partners of ours. So we don't build the physical car as you would imagine.
Is it commercially available, or what kind of the company stage are you in?
Right, so we test in six US cities currently. So we have cars on the roads at six US cities. We've also publicly announced that in 2021, we want to make Munich the first non-US city where we test. But our use case is not for the individual user. It's mobility as a service and transport as a service. So the moving of people and goods, that is the commercial use case. So the good old robo taxi, if you will, and also last mile delivery.
Got it. Excellent. Good overview. Thank you very much. Last but not least, Klaus, go ahead. You are muted. Whoops.
I know. Yeah. Oh. Now it's working. Yeah. As you said,
your video was off.
It's not one of the typical systems. Yeah. thank you for the opportunity, also through this system, to take part in the panel. I think what we've seen now, it's there's all different facets of new mobility. And I think this is what makes it very interesting, because all of them are important. And as we understand new mobility, it's more of an ecosystem of different modes of transportation, there are different facets of aspects that have to be taken into account. And I'll talk about that in a minute. So where we come from, I'm working for Siemens Mobility, especially the intelligent traffic systems part, which will be in the future Unix traffic. And we've built the first traffic light. So when you talk about the future of mobility, quite boring. But this is the heritage, and this is how traffic in cities is in most parts of the world today, and many parts, especially in the Eastern Hemisphere, where there's not even traffic lights, but there's huge traffic. So traffic becomes, especially road traffic, is still a major part of mobility, and that's something where we help cities and road authorities to provide state-of-the-art mobility and to innovate incrementally towards a future of mobility, where we would say this is something that incorporates many of the parts we've seen, or the colleagues, the other people have talked about. It's shared, it's connected, it's electric, and at some point autonomous. I mean, some years ago we expected to have autonomous cars even earlier, even by today. Hasn't happened so far. I would still hope that it's not too far away, because as we see today, the ecosystem already grows with scooters and other parts of transport modes of transportation. And I guess, Diana, what you said is like you have a seamless connection from A to B for a person. And this could include Hyperloop. This could include autonomous driving. This could include scooters, could even include walking or biking. So this is where we are partners of cities to help them to enable safe and eco-friendly and efficient mobility, building on the knowledge we have from having built the first traffic light and also employing new technologies like AI. And let me give you a few examples to make it tangible. I guess even though we have the pandemic right now, there's one other pressing challenge in the world. That's the environmental challenge. So more and more cities are understanding that they have to tackle traffic. In many cities, traffic is already back as the level before COVID, even though many people are not traveling. So we see a shift to motorized road traffic, which is even more putting a strain on the challenge they have in the cities regarding environmental topics. So there are cities, for example, in Germany, there's a city close to Frankfurt where we are implementing a Lighthouse project for environmental traffic management, where we use AI and simulation to proactively manage traffic to prevent pollution. Then with the City of London, for example, we are developing an AI-based traffic control, a network-based or network-adaptive traffic control that intelligently controls the traffic all over the city. Or in the City of Lisbon in Portugal, we are operating an e-bike sharing system where we, with AI, optimize the deployment of e-bike sharing. In the City of Lisbon, that's very interesting. They are, have implemented this e-bike sharing system as an extension of their public transit system. So really as not like only for tourists, but really as a standard traffic mode. So there we can see that not only autonomous driving, which may take some time, but will definitely be a game changer. Hyperloop, when it's there, definitely I would say, I would think too. Already today, we see there is changes undergoing in the ecosystem of mobility, and that's where we help the cities to, yeah, to approach this, to manage this, and to offer an eco-friendly and efficient mobility.
Exciting. Great. Thank you very much, everybody. So what I'm picking up here is your individual definition of new mobility. And we are going from Hyperloop over here to smart traffic lights, so to speak, like, and everything else in between. We may not have any representation here when it comes to self-flying drones or drones in general, but that's probably another topic that is part of this. But if I look at this big picture, why do we need new mobility solutions? And most importantly, why is it crucial to involve the customer in the product development cycle? And it's a little bit, I will admit, it's a little bit of a loaded question because you should always look for the customer. But for the audience here, maybe, you know, anybody here can pick this up. What is your definition of the customer? There's the end customer, there's the supplier, there's the OEM. Define customer, what your customer is, and how and if you are incorporating them into the definition of your use cases and the solution. Anybody can pick it up, please feel free.
All right, maybe I start. While our direct customers are city authorities predominantly, and I would say they have to kind of manage mobility and offer an attractive mobility. And also, as I said, first and foremost, they have to ensure safety. Then they have to increasingly account for the environmental topics. And then, as I said, the efficiency and effectiveness as an important business attractiveness factor for the city. But I mean, normal road traffic won't do the trick in the future. So they have to take care of this. I also believe that it won't work only with regulation. So they have to take into account, and there is also we have to take into account the end customer. So it has to be attractive to use, for example, different modes of transportation. Eco-friendly modes of transportation. It has to be attractive, for example, to use an autonomous vehicle, because I don't care how long it takes or if I take a detour because it's more eco-friendly, because I can work in it, I have my private bubble. Or it has to be attractive to share because it's cheaper. So it's really something where also for us, the end customer, it's just you and me, it's every person, has kind of, you have to take into account at the same time. We have to, it's more a societal issue. So mobility is not that everybody can optimize his or her own preferences or trip. It's more like that take into account the whole society and those challenges, cities and road authorities have to, mobility authorities have to find ways to motivate the end customer to use the best way to travel.
And okay.
I can jump in on that because we actually have a very similar definition of customer as what Klaus mentioned. So our Virgin Hyperloop's direct customers are whoever is building the Hyperloop system, and oftentimes with infrastructure and with transportation, that is government agencies, or sometimes it's a mixture of public and private consortiums that are building these types of infrastructure projects. However, when we are designing the Hyperloop system itself, we also keep in mind the end customer. So also similar to what Klaus mentioned, the people who are actually using the system, or in some cases, yeah, the cargo customers that are putting their cargoes and entrusting us with the movement of their cargoes to their ultimate destination. So in designing it, we have both customers in mind, which is often a little bit tricky because you've got multiple bosses in that sense, multiple customers and different things that you are trying to achieve with each one. Why is new mobility solutions, why are they important? I think if you see the way the conversations lately have been going and the priorities of our direct customers, oftentimes governments, you realize that climate solutions, technology solutions that address climate change are very, very important in today's society. So the global population is expected to reach 10 billion by 2050. We have to create new and more efficient solutions to meet the demands of the upcoming decades that can lessen the impact on climate change. We've also seen that lately there has been announced a ban on short haul flights in France. So flights that have train alternatives that are less than 2.5 hours available will be banned. And there's a huge impact on this when you're thinking about the shift in passengers from aviation to rail and what that means for the rail capacity. For example, the train line, the high-speed rail line from Paris to Lyon is already at capacity from an infrastructure perspective. And they're also thinking about adding a second line to that. So what does that mean in terms of, the shift in how people think about new transportation options? I mean, this is why new mobility is so important to us today. And Hyperloop is a technology that can be 10 times more efficient, energy efficient than air travel. With respect to product development, I think this is an extremely important question, Thomas, that you bring up about bringing the customers into the development of the product itself. Yeah. And also similar to what Klaus mentioned, if the technology is not designed for the passengers, for the end customers, nobody will use it.
Exactly.
Nobody will buy it. And so, yeah, of course, we have to design that with the customer in mind and ensure that as we are developing the technology, that we keep that in mind. We've hosted multiple focus groups across three continents around the world to understand how people think about traveling in a Hyperloop. And actually, what's very interesting is that the number one question we get is about what happens when I travel in a steel container with no windows, going extremely fast, will I feel claustrophobic? And this is a question that we get across the world, across all different audiences. And that is, it's very interesting because it doesn't necessarily speak to an actual, medical condition that somebody may have, because actually not that many people have claustrophobia, but it speaks to an underlying fear of trying something new, of trying a new technology. And what we've tried to do in these focus groups is actually untangle where that fear is coming from and what we can do as a technology provider to address that fear. Maybe not the underlying medical conditions, but what is driving that fear. So we've realized that actually this idea of being in this enclosed space makes people feel very nervous. So what have we done? We have installed skylights on the top of our pod so that it seems similar to the lighting actually that goes into the pod is similar to the way the light would be reflected, the sunlight would be reflected if you were actually having a glass container where you can see the sky itself. And so that way, you create this feeling of security, of comfort, in this system. And so you're addressing actually the underlying fear that is driving all of these questions. And so for us, that's why it's really important to have these discussions directly with the end users of the system, and in order to ensure that we're taking all of that into account as we're developing the technology.
That is very interesting. Just one comment, Sarah. That's actually very interesting, because you are almost explaining the borderline into like almost virtual reality. Mm-hmm. Because if you put somebody in a box, you know, the box is the box, but you could have a high resolution video playing, or you're going through a digital representation of a forest, and you have the skyline with the blue sky, and you sit there, and over time, you may not even remember where you are in the physical world, because you are so stimulated by the virtual world that you just created in these bots. That's an interesting futuristic view. But I like the answer, because you're not only bringing in the customer or the end customer in regards to the city who has to put this on with the infrastructure in place and has to have the budget. It's actually by the end, the user itself, the individual who has to have the mindset and the willingness to actually buy a ticket and get into that kind of a form of a new transportation. That's so right. That's a very insightful comment. Thank you very much. Sarah, you had a question or you had a comment? Please go ahead.
Yeah, I got a comment, because I think this is something which is also, which already started to change in the product and service development in Germany as well. Because in the former times, especially German automotive, aviation or transport industry, we were developing our products only by ourselves. And I mean, we are famous for our German engineering. And until we got the final 100% solution, and and before we won't go out on the market, but this is changing a lot, or have started to change a lot. I mean, today a solution shouldn't be driven by the technology alone, but rather by idea generation using crowdsourcing, for example, or if you do a test lab before you start with the serial production, like you do with Hyperloop, you really involve the customers and see what are their fears, what they like, what they don't. And finally, you get new kind of fans, the users. They really become product and brand fans because they are involved in a very early stage. And this is something also we found out during our test lab last year. When you involve the customer in an early point, when you get a first prototype, for example, it's something totally different what they think about your product, even if it's not perfect at the moment already. But they were involved, and this is what the people like. They like to become a part of it. They like to share their ideas, how to improve it or come up with some new features, for example. And I think this pandemic, it also showed us, I mean, people are social creatures and they still need human interaction. And I think in many cases, of course, you can do a lot like we do it now on digital channels, but it will never be the same like meeting physical. And it's not always the best solution in terms of collaboration. So therefore, I'm deeply convinced that mobility is a key, not only for the global trade and supply we need, also in the pandemic now more than ever, but it's also the vehicle to guarantee a local and global life social interaction. And this is why I think it's so important. And if you want to involve different kind of stakeholders, of course, it's your customers. But it's not only, I mean, in our business, of course, first of all, it's B2B. So the companies usually rent the offices or the location for prototyping and showrooms. But we always have to think about the end users, finally. What will they think about the project later on? Will they use it? How will they use it? How do different people from different places react? So because if you... I mean, if you, for example, develop a product for a European market, sometimes it has to be totally different, like the product for the US or for the Asian market. And then this is why I think it's so important, also if you're into B2B business, to involve your B2C customers in order to get an idea whether they will use it or not. Because in the end, it's the market and the people who will decide about the success of your business model.
Yeah. Good feedback. Thank you. Florian, quick question to you as well. How do you bring the customer or the end customer into your product development cycle? How does it look on your end?
So I think what we do is, and that is adding maybe an aspect that hasn't yet been mentioned. So we don't only think of our commercial customers, which could be our OEM partners or mobility service providers, for example, or the people who will end up riding in the vehicles equipped with our self-driving system. We also have to think about essentially everyone and anyone who might interact with an autonomous vehicle on public roads, right? So that is a whole different set of people. In many cases, vulnerable road users, such as cyclists, pedestrians, people on e-scooters, people in wheelchairs. And so safety is really the top concern that we have when we're developing the products. And we think about all these interactions that could possibly happen with the vehicles that are equipped with our self-driving system. And we will never deploy our SDS until our safety standards are fully met. So we really have to think really in the truest sense of the word, outside the box, outside the metal box that our technology comes in, and take all of that into account. So perhaps that is something that should be mentioned here as well, because we do interact in real life scenarios on public roads, in cities, with individuals that are not used to running into a vehicle that doesn't have anyone in the driver's seat.
Okay, thank you. Before I move to the next question, actually I have a side question. It just popped up in regards to adoption of the technology and adoption of change in general, right? Having an Uber service. Uber didn't exist 10 years ago. I don't think anybody would have ever imagined that we have all these ride sharing apps and that we have an app now and you call an Uber and all the stuff that goes in it. And yet at the same time, nothing really was invented that hasn't been there before. The internet was there, connectivity, the apps, and now you take cars and enable people to do it. In regards to the adoption, and this is a question for everybody, what does it take for the adoption of your solution that you are working on? And how long will it take for the adoption to take place? And the answers may be fundamentally different from a smart traffic light to a Hyperloop, obviously, but I would like to hear your feedback. Klaus, you want to go first?
Yeah, maybe I can go first. So I would say it's a very differentiated answer. So first of all, it really depends on, are we in the physical world? Are we in the software, the virtual world? So as soon as it's concerns like when you take on autonomous driving, for example, where we also provide infrastructure for that, which may be needed at some points. There's always a discussion, do we need separate lanes, for example? If you have California, there's like, it's sunshine, there's wide roads. In a European, very tight city where it's sometimes maybe raining a lot, that may be different. Yeah, maybe different challenges, like looking around the corner, is there somebody crossing the road and so on. So I think this is really something you can't answer generally, how the adoption is. Secondly, what you need to differentiate, is it like something that you can do privately, or do you need public authorities? Now, this is something where we could also say this is something where we need to really, with an advantage, we have local specifics, because in the US at some points it's easier to implement something, to try out something, to ramp up a pilot than is in other regions in the world. So I think the openness of public authorities to enable pilots to accompany that, and also to be able to adapt the regulations and the frame conditions, that's really a major cornerstone, a major part of enabling fast adoption. And then in the private part, that's in the private sector, I think we've seen that with many things out of the internet, if they provide a lot of value, people will adopt it really quickly, in a second. Yeah, so it will go really fast. So it's more or less the frame conditions, and as I said, how far does it go to the physical world and how much investment does it take?
Diana, what do you think? Yours is obviously a different time frame, but I would love to know by when can I sit into that kind of a vehicle to go in 30 minutes from Los Angeles to Las Vegas?
Well, you can't go there. You can't sit in one of those vehicles right now, but you can come to our test site and you can sit in our test vehicle.
Okay.
But you'll only be able to go 500 meters. I think ultimately the adoption of this technology has to depend on whether or not it solves a need. The greater the need, the more pressing the need, I think the easier the adoption will be. I mean, you brought up a great example with Uber. Why was Uber able to be so successful? Well, it was because people really had a need to be able to get across the city in a way yeah. that was more affordable and easier to use than just flagging down a taxi. I remember at the time Uber came on onto the scene, I was living in New York City, and there were certain times of the day where it was, and especially when it rained, where it was literally impossible to get a taxi. And I remember thinking, yeah. wow, wouldn't it be amazing? I mean, I would pay a lot of money just to be able to make sure that I had that service when I really, really needed it to go to the airport or something like that. So I think it really solved a need that was really pressing for a lot of people. And that's why we were able to see such high adoption of that type of service as well. So, you know, I think when we talk about adoption and we talk about the specific markets that we're looking at, we also look at the need and what kind of problem and what kind of bottlenecks are we looking to solve. And I think those are the areas where you'll get the most adoption. So for people, it's, you know, for example, the corridor between Los Angeles to Las Vegas, which we as a company travel a lot. Sometimes when you look at the travel time driving, it's 3.5 hours or 4 hours if you go at 5 a.m. in the morning. And other times it's 7 hours or eight hours. It took me 7 hours to get back from Las Vegas the other week. And that kind of unreliability affects so many people. And it's really a really pressing issue. And it's just very amazing that there's no solution right now that exists for that kind of market. And I think what we're trying to build is enabling the technology to solve those issues and those problems that people face.
Yeah. Maybe moving on to the next question. Obviously, this is Innovation Week. That's why we're gathering here. And looking at that, we have a new Biden administration here in the United States. There is an election in Germany later this year in September, October. And the question is related to the overall topic, the transatlantic relationships, the transatlantic exchanges. How crucial and how important is it in the global world to not only nurture it, but particularly with these topics that we are discussing? Because this is not only a global issue, it's also a regional one. And you cannot do it in isolation. You cannot do it within a country or within a state or within a small region. Within your individual corporations and activities, how important is the transatlantic relationships on eye level, rather than, you know, there's the United States versus Germany or Europe? How important is it, and how do you engage with that kind of a dynamic? Anybody, please.
I would like to.
Sarah, yeah.
That in what we do, and I mean, to my opinion, intercultural and cross-industry collaboration is so important because the changing demand. Our demands ask for a cooperation between the champions in their technology or business field. I mean, it was always the best if you focus on what your assets are or what your skills are about and find the best partner for the missing technology or the part needed to come up with a successful model. So to my opinion, of course, it's also important to always support local businesses, of course. But you should never forget to have a broader perspective and see who is the best champion dealing with it in terms of new technologies, for example. and how could we collaborate with them? So this is for us, for example, it's very important to have an intercultural and cross-industry collaboration also with companies from the US. And I mean, as a US company needs to transform its product to the local demand here in Germany, to the market fit, it's the other way around. If a company from Germany is moving to United States and is just opening a sales office there, it won't be the same success like in the home country. So you should always involve the local experts in the collaboration with another country and of course also your customers there into your product lifecycle. So, and this is, I mean, I give an example. We developed Lab Campus as a smart city, kind of smart city in cooperation with the MIT Sensible City Lab. Because they are known as world champions concerning data transformation, from data analysis to concrete new solutions for a new city or a campus like Lab Campus. And this is why I think it's crucial to see who is a champion and which kind of technology and who knows how the customers think and how you get access to the customers. Because it's not only the direct access by the customers you already know because you get them. You all want, I mean, it's very important that you also involve customers coming up, which could be the customers of the future. And this is why I think it's very important to have a very intense collaboration, especially in terms of, we have so many in common with the United States in terms of how we come up with new ideas and how we want to translate them into daily business. So this is why I think it's very important to go on and work together. So, I mean, picking the right location for your innovation spot is crucial to grow with the upcoming needs of your new market. And to my opinion, US and Germany share great common values and ideas to transform today into a great sustainable and inclusive tomorrow, also in terms of the mobility, of course.
That's a good insight. That's a good viewpoint. Anybody else?
Yeah, perhaps adding to that, I just want to say that to us at Argo, the transatlantic relationship and transatlantic collaboration is really core to our DNA. We, through our partnerships with Ford and Volkswagen, are actually the only self-driving technology company in the world with commercial agreements for deployment both in the United States and in Europe, and with a large presence in Europe as well through our European headquarters here in Munich. So that informs and shapes our day-to-day, every day, and makes it a much more diverse and interesting place to work. And that also affects, obviously, the products. When you think about testing autonomous vehicles, for example, with 6 cities already live and deployed, and then adding European cities now, that actually also makes ours perhaps the largest and most diverse active urban footprint of any AV developer. And with the vast differences between European cities and US cities, that is just very, very enriching for the overall product. At the same time, deployment of autonomous vehicles obviously needs a lot of new laws to be written, right? Mm-hmm. Germany is currently the only country in the world that is in the process of passing a law for fully autonomous vehicles to be deployed on public roads on the national level, hopefully to be passed by June of this year. So that is very exciting, in part because we now see the new US government also making moves in that space on the national level, right? So what we are perhaps seeing is a sort of transatlantic cross-pollination, not only in technology, but perhaps in legislation as well, where the US government takes cues from what the Germans have done, and vice versa, perhaps going forward. So that is just something that makes it very exciting in our space.
That's an important point, yes. Klaus, Siemens is definitely truly a global company. How are you taking your technologies from Germany and bringing it to the United States, or maybe even the other way around first?
Yeah, definitely. So it's both ways. So I would say, as long as it's regarding hardware, so for example, our controllers, traffic lights, and so on, there we have a factory in Kentucky that produces the hardware for the US and Canada. In Germany, we have factories also in the UK. So that's a relatively local business. But as soon as it comes to software business, so our advanced traffic management systems, there I would say it really plays an important role to have, let's say, more global solutions that cater for the local requirements. And you're talking more about, let's say, configuration than customization, or let's say, yeah, still customized, but not customer-specific developments, but rather customer-specific configurations. So, and secondly, I mean, you're in the Silicon Valley. There's a great innovation power. So there's plenty of startups, great of ideas, and our systems, they have been proprietary in the past, and they will open up more and more. Also, we build solutions, for example, for US customers. We relatively often team up with companies. You could still sometimes call them startups, maybe not in the early stage, but also with let's say, smaller companies, not only the big ones, where we use their innovation power and bring it together with our innovation power in each field, and then we collaborate. This, I think this is where the first spark provides a lot of value. And then when you bring this out of a project or a customer's into a product and you can scale it globally, you still have to adapt it, maybe to the local needs, but you can scale the general idea and maybe the basic development in your software solutions. This is where we see a lot of value. And that's definitely specifically with the US, because there's all the innovations you named, or many of them came out of the US. So there's certainly also not only that we bring our product solutions into the US, we also benefit a lot from joint collaboration.
Okay. Diana mentioned something earlier about the need or solving a problem like the Uber, right? We didn't know, but then when it was there, we had it. But I do remember at the same time, and this may be a cultural and maybe even a little bit of a government thing, when Uber then was trying to enter the European market, I do remember, and particularly being a German here in Silicon Valley, that I saw huge resistance in Germany not the adoption of the end user, the government resisting to actually allow Uber as a service to be offered. And to top that on, and that may be a cultural thing, in France, I saw on the news, you know, burning cars and, you know, people being on the street. Is that something that you expect in any of your areas, that there is a resistance that harsh as people have seen it with the adoption of a new service like Uber? Or this is more a small migration into, you know, what people are used to today, just to the next level? Or everybody doesn't see that happening?
Sarah? I remember...
Oh, Diane, yeah, go ahead.
Go on, Diana. Go
ahead. I mean, I remember with Uber, even there was a lot of resistance, even in the U.S. I mean, I remember the taxi cab medallions in New York City, which, you know, had been passed down from generation to generation, and the value of those medallions, you know, which were worth hundreds of thousands of dollars, essentially, ended up being close to zero overnight, and that was certainly very, very much an issue for the families that had paid for those medallions. And so I think it was not just in Europe, but I think in the US as well. And every time you see an introduction of a new technology or a new service that changes the way people live their lives, I think there's always going to be some hesitation in adoption of it. But of course, this gets back to ultimately the value that this technology brings to the people and to the communities and what that means. I think if you're adding value, if you're addressing a bottleneck, or if you're addressing a pain point for your customers, ultimately, you know, that will be felt and that will be heard across the community. And you know, and I think people will react to that. And governments, of course, are made up by the will of the people that they serve, and they will listen and react to that as well. So I think that's why you see the technologies like Uber and like Lyft still being around today, because it very clearly reflects that they have addressed something that was very much needed.
agree. And with that, we are, I just noticed, we could talk forever here. It's a very interesting, exciting topic. I hope it was valuable for everybody who listened into the session. Thank you, everybody, for taking your time, sharing some very insightful knowledge about how the future of mobility will look like. With that, I wish everybody in Germany and on the transatlantic US side here a very fruitful innovation week. And with that, I would like to close the session. Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.